Thank you. I will not say my name. I'm sure you cannot pronounce my name, which is no problem because I cannot pronounce your name either, so that makes us even. Welcome. I'm very happy to see you. I arrived the day before yesterday in Novosibirsk, first time in Siberia, so I wanted to do some sightseeing. So I rented a car and I went to Akadem Gorodok, and basically I drove 1 hour east just to see the landscape. Well, it's a bit empty. And I found out that almost nobody in Siberia talks English. And this is an English talk, so I'm very happy to see so many people to my talk. You're my friends, we can communicate. Great, thank you. We will talk about testing in groups. There's a lot of talks about test automation, but still we have acceptance testing. Still we have users in some projects where they have to accept the software. And you can do this by using scripts. I don't like using scripts. I love exploratory testing. And you can also do it in groups. And that works very, very good. But first, I would like to show you a small movie. Did you see where this was? This was in Novosibirsk. This is what you call a mob. And what we basically did was applying a mob, a dance mob, to testing. And what you saw were just a lot of people who had an appointment with each other, who said, on a certain time, we will be on a certain place, doing a certain thing. In this case, dancing. And if you look at this movie again, it's on YouTube, just Dance Mob Novosibirsk, you'll find it. You will see that not everybody in the movie is a professional dancer. This guy with the blue shirt, yeah, he is pretty professional. I have to admit that. But there are also people who are not professional. And in test mobs, you can also apply other people who are not professional. So basically, a test mob or a bug hunt, we will come what the difference is on later, is that people come together at a certain point of time on a certain place to do something together and just split up. And because they're doing it together, it looks much better than doing it alone. This guy in the blue shirt dancing alone on this square in the middle of Novosibirsk is a bit odd, isn't it? So why are you testing alone? Why don't you test together? That's more fun. So this talk will be about collaboration, about having fun, about doing things in group, about making projects successful, and yeah, it's also a bit about testing, but you can apply this to everything. So this is the agenda. First, I want to thank some people who inspired me deeply to do this. And then we will have some theoretical talk, and then I will show you how we did this in practice and really changed a project with it. So these people inspired me very much. I went to two conferences in a short period of time where I heard talks about test mobs, Os Chiwayi and Candice Mesk. I met them actually in Israel, but they are from South Africa, and they talked about mob programming, and I thought, I should apply this to testing. And 2 weeks later, Marit P. Hajarvi, that's really her name, she talked about test mobs as well. and then I really applied it. So I want to thank them for inspiring me. The theoretical part. Bug hunt, test mob, what's the difference? There's no formal definition of what a bug hunt is. But it's, I found something in an article, and it's a robust exploratory testing session. You know the difference between scripted and exploratory testing? A lot of working up front with making scripts or more applying to what's happening with exploratory testing. Bug hunts and test mobs are more exploratory testing. So not very much preparation up front, but more acting on what's happening during your test session. It's a test session to find bugs and vulnerabilities in applications. And I'll put the next sentence in as well. In bug hunts, testers carry out functional testing with a specific purpose of finding defects. So you're really looking for the defects. I know a lot of people say that the goal of testing is to build confidence. Well, I've done a lot of testing, and it was not always building confidence. No, you're really hunting for the bugs, and that's cool. It's a joint test session with different people. I did it mostly with users, but you can also invite developers, management, etc., etc. When I do a bug hunt or a test mob, I take at least 2 hours. Why? It takes a time to get the people in. It takes the time to get them in the right mode, so in the right testing mode. It takes time to discuss the outcomes. So you lose a lot of time. And if you have 1 hour, you have maybe 30, 40 minutes of actual testing time. So you can better have longer sessions. Here it says 2 to 4 hours. 4 hours is a bit long in my idea. You can test alone in pairs. This is a quite often seen room layout when you're doing bug hunts. People have their own screen, have their own laptop or screen or whatever, and they're testing alone or in pairs. But they're not in one group, but they're testing apart from each other. You have an organizer here with a PowerPoint screen, but most of the time during the bug hunt, as organizer, you don't have to do anything. So I always start testing myself. And yes, you do some preparation. You do not make detailed scripts. Users know what the system should do. They are users. They know their own processes. They know what the system how the system should work. But what you should not do is just say to them, "Go in. Here is the application. Go test it." Now, if you got, let's say, 3 different pairs, you're testing this part. You're looking for this kind of bugs, and you're testing that part. So everybody has got his own goals with the testing. So yes, you do some preparation, and you could make a test charter. If you don't know what a test charter is, a lot of information on the internet, but it's a kind of documentation light. It's not very detailed scripts, throw them away, but just say to them, this process, please test it. And you got an hour for it, or something like that. So you can't read the details, it was not meant to be, but you could make a one-page test charter to guide them. You could also make that, using a mind map. I use mind maps all the time because you can have different layers of information. So, and I always add, most of the times I add a competition with it. If you find an easy bug, there's something miswritten or something, that's a category 4, it's only 1 point. If you really find a bug that should never have gotten into production because it's really damaging the system, you get 25 points. So I add a competition in it. And cookies. There are always cookies on a bug hunt or test mob when I organize it. If we look at what test mobs are, there's a definition. A group of brilliant people working at the same time, on the same thing, at the same time, in the same space, on the same computer. And that's, theoretically seen, the difference between a bug hunt and a test mob. With a test mob, everybody is looking at the same screen. And with bug hunts, everybody is, or in pairs, looking at their own screen. So here you're really testing together and coming to an end with each other. So deciding how it should look. Joint test sessions, everybody working together. You got three different roles. By the way, in theory, if you read the articles about it, you got two roles. That's the driver and the navigator. The driver is the one who's hitting the keyboard. But he or she is not allowed to think. Because otherwise, the others are looking at someone testing. No, the navigators are saying what the driver should do. So the other ones are the tester, and the driver is just the intermediate between the application and the testers. And you should change the driver every 20 minutes, because it's not a nice role just doing what other people are telling you. I often add a scribe to it. If we find a bug, then the scribe will file the bug, will document the bug. And yes, it's exploratory testing. So this is a typical room layout for a test mob. We're all looking at one screen, and there the application under test is projected, and a lot of people are watching it, and here we have the driver. And like I said, I often add a scribe to it, but in theory, that should not be done. Cookies, yeah. Also here, very important. This joint test session has a goal, so everybody knows this process or this part of the application we're going to test. Got a different scope, maybe some test points, not test cases. A test point is more an idea what you could test. And then you're going to explore this, the fun part of it. And you could use mind maps again to document things or to do some preparation. You had the boring part of the presentation. Thank you for still being here and being awake. Now we're coming to the practical part. How did I apply this in practice? I was coming from these two conferences where I heard about test mobs and programming mobs, etc., and I thought, I'm going to apply this. And I was applying it in a very traditional, old-fashioned project. So we heard Sander Hogedorn, the only one who can pronounce his name, this morning talk about agile and making things small and deliver fast. Nothing of that in this particular project. We also have old-fashioned projects in the Netherlands. And that was a very old-fashioned project. Project management, where the steering committee, development, data migration and testing in different teams. So really these silos. And there was somewhere the business. I was not really sure where it was in the project. To get to the business, we had to go two floors down and then some hallways down and very far away. So that was also geographically, they were far away. Not only organizational, but also geographically, they were far away. And we had a tremendous couple of problems. So one of the problems we had the day I came back from the second conference was that there were some bugs, and they were ping-ponged, you know, table tennis ping-pong between the development team and the business. And they didn't speak to each other. They only communicated using Jira. I hate Jira as well. So just deinstall it, and maybe people start to talk with each other. Well, I couldn't deinstall Jira, so I had to think of something else, and I thought, hey, this mob thing. So this is actually the first mob that we did in this project. And this guy over here is a developer. He says hi. And this guy over here is a developer. This is a user. This is a user. I thought there was a second lady, a third user. This is a user. And they were discussing the defects. These defects that had been ping-ponged several times between business and development. So what is your problem? Well, on that screen over there, oh, but you could do it in a different way. You could do this. Okay, that is not a defect. Let's do the next one. That's your problem. We could solve it over here. And they just code it live during this session. Is this what you want? Okay, next defect. In this session, we did in 2 hours about 16 to 18 defects. These 16 defects, they were open for more than 2 months. And they had at least 3 times been passed to the business and back again to the development team. So 16 in only 2 hours, that was a huge success. So if defects were not clear in described and the developers didn't know what to do, they programmed it for the next. We call this a mop. It is more like a bug hunt, but no, we're looking at the same screen. It's a mop. And we did this every week, and that worked pretty well. So the fixing of defects was much better. And then we thought, well, we should do this more often. And then we got to a real bug hunt. So here we're testing. Before we were fixing bugs, so more a programming mop. And you see couples. I was sitting over here. I was testing with her. They're two users. I was the only non-user. Sometimes we had mops where developers were. But that was not always a success. So we tried different things, but developers wanted to explain what they did instead of testing. So it was more a demo than a testing session. So here we have a session without any developers. Sometimes, that was actually the best thing, they came in the last half an hour and then we explained what we found. That worked pretty good, actually. We did a lot of these kind of sessions, which 6 people is great. And every half an hour, we said, let's have a look what we found and what we can tell about the system based on what we found. And suppose we had a part of the system under test, and we found a lot of defects, we just stopped testing and we said, it's not ready for acceptance yet. So do it again. And instead of spending an hour on it, we spent half an hour on it, and we shifted our ideas. On sessions like these, most of the times the teams are testing a different part. And after 25 minutes, we took 5 minutes to show each other what we found. Third variations was with management. Management heard, well, hey, this is working very good, and we're finding bugs, and maybe you should come as well. Maybe that was not a very good idea. This guy over here, it's the only picture with management on it. He's the COO, and he was the main management guy who was in these kind of sessions. But we had more management in. But they started to discuss what they were testing, how they were how they were working, and that they should work in a different way. Management has an idea what the users are actually doing, but mostly that idea is wrong. So we ended up in a lot of discussions how we should do our work instead of testing, which is great, but not on my time, not on my shift. So I was not really happy with management being in the room. Also because they were pretty I had all kind of goals with the session, and they always wanted to shift the goal. No, but I want to see this today. Yeah, but that's programmed for later this week. No, but we should do it today. Yeah, but I didn't prepare it. Who cares? So management in a session like this, not every user is open and honest about everything. So I wasn't really happy with it. The fourth was an end-to-end mop. End-to-end testing is always difficult, and in this case we had this this architecture of different systems, which was processing different cases through the system. And how do you test that? You fire off a new case, and it should be good in the first application, the first unit, second unit, et cetera, et cetera. So what we actually did, here is the driver. You can't see him. And he's firing off a case, like a document X with so many pages and with color. And it's basically a document management system we were building. And here's the first tester. You can hardly see him. But he said, well, it arrived. It took so much time. I can see the right number of pages. I can see his color. And then all the different systems. This is the last system. This is the web shop where you could buy the documents. So here it was enriched with more details. Here the price was set, etc. And he is the scribe. So if we had any defects, they were described to him, and he was putting it in Jira right away. He's a developer, and he could help us when we had any problems with the end-to-end test. So this was working pretty good, actually, because we had all these different systems, and nobody had an overview of all the systems. Nobody had the knowledge of all the systems. So here we were doing the end-to-end test really effective. The fifth one is not a really mob, but I want to show you. Here you see the same manager again. So the most important manager for us. Here what you see is the complete management team of this organization. The basic systems of this organization were replaced with a new one. So they had to really have confidence that it was working well. This is the left side of the room. At the right side of the room, you see different systems. They were displayed using beamers, and they could really see that it was actually working. We did about 25, 30 cases, and we knew they were working beforehand, because if you got a discussion with management, it takes a lot of time. And the go, no-go decision was taken by management, not by the project. And they saw, they didn't take the go, no-go decision based on the document, but they saw that it was working. That was cool. This is also called a demo, but we called it a mob. And demo and mob, there are some differences, but not very much. The benefits. The biggest benefit was that the complete organization, the complete project changed. And this was really cool. Like I said, there were these silos, and the business was sitting somewhere else in the building. We had to walk for 5 minutes to get to the business. So we were not communicating with each other. We were sending each other documents. That's not communication. So we changed the old style project to multifunctional teams. And multifunctional teams is something you hear in Agile. You hear in DevOps. But the management was saying, this new fashion Agile, we don't want to have Agile. So Waterfall has proven itself. Well, personally, I think it's proven itself wrong, but that's an opinion. But they didn't want to have any Agile thing. At the end of the project, we had daily stand-ups. We had a multifunctional team. We had a Scrum board. And we had all different Agile things, but we didn't do Agile. No, we didn't do Agile. We had 2-week sprints, by the way, as well. So by using mobs, we changed the project organization. With testing, we were in the lead of how we were doing things. I think that's pretty cool. If you look a level deeper, you see that the basic benefit was that business and IT were talking to each other. They were communicating with each other face to face. Developers in the same room as testers. We started to do development mobs. We started to do program mobs. We started to do all kind of mobs. And at the end of the project, you saw that the business people were at the project more often. Client number two and three are a bit smaller, but here you see a picture of a typical bug hunt. They're all working by themselves. This is a colleague of mine. I know he looks like an ISIS terrorist, but he's a colleague of mine. That's a very nice guy. What he did very well was manage the bomb mobs very, very well. What you see here are process designs. Under it, there were test charters. They were given to the users, and they knew exactly what to do. So he was also having all these Excels. Here you see different processes. You can't read it, but it's in Dutch anyway. So, and here you see the different stages of testing, preparation, execution, bug fixing, etc. And here you have the progress, and at the end of the project, you see that the progress was 100%. So he had much better oversight than I had. He also had this planning, who should test what when. So everybody knew when they had to come for a bug hunt. And we made the test charters again. Client number three, I took it because it's different because we did the test mobs within the development team. There were no users here. Some people say that test mobs can only be used for acceptance testing. It's not true. These are all developers. This guy is a tester of the team, by the way, and he's the UX designer. But they were working on their own user stories. And when the user story was finished, they not really demoed it, but they really tested it together. Because when someone changed something, something else could misfunction. So they were really having test sessions instead of demos, which worked pretty well as well. Success factors, and last thing, preparation, very important. Make sure your test environment is working. Make sure you have your test charters ready, you have your test design ready. Invite the right people, people with knowledge of the system, and don't invite the developers if you don't want to have discussion, things like that. Administration of defects, of tested features. I'm not a hero in it, my colleague is better in it. Make sure the people have time available. Some people came in and said, oh, well, I'm going to leave in 1 hour. No, you're not going to leave in 1 hour, you're going to leave now, or you're going to leave in 2 hours, but the test session is 2 hours. So, and if they don't have time available, the project doesn't have time available. An organizer, a guy like me who's making sure everything is done well. Follow up, make sure that the defects are filed properly, etc., etc. And very important, cookies. Did I mention that cookies are very important? I was thinking about bringing Dutch cookies, but I thought, well, for 200 people, that takes too much time. Sorry for that. It's all about energy. The people should be energized to test, to have fun, to explore new things. And if there's no energy, get them together and ask why. What am I doing wrong? What should we change? And we really had an evolution of test mobs within this big project, within the other project as well, but I only visited twice. People got a lot of energy from the test mob. Sometimes they were coming out of the test mob saying, ooh, this software isn't ready yet. But 2 weeks later, they saw the software again, and then, wow, this is much better. Ah, we could go into production with it. And we have to convince management, okay. But it's all about energy. These should be very energetic sessions. And that brings me, I think, right on time. I saw the 5 minutes sign. If you don't dare to ask any question, I was once in Moscow, nobody asked a question, I was getting out and people were jumping on me because they had a lot of questions. I'm here 2 days, so you can always ask questions.
Hello, thank you. And what do you think about public bug hunt program?
About what?
You told about bug hunting, which provided in one room. And what do you think about public? When a big company offers, so they will buy for bugs. What do you think about that?
Yeah. First thing, make sure you test it before you show it to the public. That's I've done. Yeah, I see some people recognizing things. I've also seen some organizations just asking, test this. It's more effective if you say, could you test the security? Could you test the usability? Could you test the process of making a entering a new client, etc., etc.? So give people a specific purpose to test. And if you're making an app, I'm in a project right now. We're making an app for 100,000 users a day. Yes, we're doing public testing as well. Yeah, it adds really value in that situation. In the project before, the web shop was already there, so we didn't do that in that case. But if you're making an app for a lot of users, I should do it, definitely. Yeah.
Got it. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Еще вопросы, не стесняемся.
Was I so clear or so boring? Be honest with me.
very clear.
I see clear. A question over there. It's a long run. Oh, no.
Hello, Jan. My name is Mikhail. I was just wondering. You have managers, you have developers in your team of testing,
yeah.
But time of these people is cost and money. And you
yeah.
spend it on a group testing, group therapy, maybe. I don't know how it's called. Isn't cost too much for your company?
The software they were delivering before we were communicating very well didn't have any value. So we spent money and there was something delivered with no value. But making them work together may cost more money, but they delivered value. And it's all about value. So yes, I think that's what it should be about.
Okay, and one more question. Do you have some test engineers in your team?
Yeah. We had three test engineers. I was test manager, and the test engineers were testing before the bug hunts or test mobs, because we don't want to show untested code to the users. So they were doing the system test, and what you saw was the acceptance test. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah. Got any questions? I'm here for 2 days, and otherwise there's only one guy with my name, and you can spell it, so you can also ask by LinkedIn or something like that. Thank you very much.